مبارزه در افغانستان برای صلح آسان نیست. فعلاً اگر جنگ باشه خود اینجا ما شما نمیتونید زندگی بکنیم.
خطرناکت گرد؟ میخوره انسان نه؟
آی تو گردن
نمی یا مرگاک میخوره؟
نه که میخوره ما باید توقف بدیم و خاموش بشن دین دیانه ای جنگ
ما باید توقف بدیم و بشناسیم این زندگی مقدس و فانی داره ما
باید کرامتی و خود را نگاه کنیم و تا نکنیم مرگ ما مردم عام باید دیانگی را خلاص کنیم
چرا هم دیگر رو میکشید آدم کشتن مردم عبرت رو حق بده
آدم کشتن رفتان و چیزای خود رو حق میبرد
وقتی که جهان خوبی جنگ رو چیز میکند ما با احترام چیزدن این رو رد
ما باید به صلح به عوضی یک انعام باشک باید یک فرصتی بشک کنیم
از گفت بیرونی اول بس
است. سلی واقع ضرور است.
محبت هم خیلی خاص نسیم دارد.
Watched some young people from the Bamiyan province of Afghanistan expressing their deep desire for peace. I'm Glenn Anderson. The Olympia Fellowship of Reconciliation's TV program explores a variety of issues that relate to peace, social justice, and nonviolent social change. This month's program will inform you about what these young people in Afghanistan are doing for peace and what people here in our own community are doing to help spread their message. We watched one of their videos. They've produced a number of others. Here now is one of their first videos. It starts with Abdullahi, who's 13 years old, and he's actually the leader of this group. And so here's this other introductory video, and then we'll proceed with the interview after you've had a chance to see that.
چرا شما پدر ما کشتی؟ شما حتی او را نشناختی؟
اتفاق بچن قیمت جور می شود چرا عوض از این مانون جور نمی دی؟
چرا مردم شوروی پاکستان ایران و ایران و امریکا و خوی ما افغانستان میگم ما همیشه میگم ما
شما
Bamiyan province is near the center of Afghanistan, but you can see from their videos that the area seems very remote. These kids live in a harsh climate at a very high altitude in the mountains. You might remember Bamiyan province as the location where the giant Buddha statues existed for many hundreds of years, until the Taliban destroyed them in 2001. We'll be learning more about what these kids are doing, and we'll be talking with some local folks who are collaborating with them for peace and reconciliation and our common humanity. I'm happy to welcome three guests, Dennis Mills, Jasmine Ramsey, and Doug Mackey. Dennis, Jazzy, and Doug have all been inspired by these young people in Afghanistan. All three of our guests have been sharing these young people's messages of peace and understanding to our community and beyond. Both Dennis and Doug are very active with the Olympia Fellowship of Reconciliation. Jazzy attends the Evergreen State College. Welcome. We're glad you're all here.
Thank you. We appreciate the opportunity to be here.
This will be juicy and inspiring, I hope. Is there anything else that needs to be said about Bamiyan province or the setting for these kids?
Not other than they did experience tremendous violence at the time period you're talking about, about 8 years ago. Uh-huh. And then it settled down there during the year that followed. So some of the conflict is occurring, the conflict that's occurring now is outside of that area. So there's been some peace, but it'd be like saying that, you know, it's fine here in Olympia, but in Portland they're still dropping bombs.
Right.
So it's
Also, you'll see some mountains in the background, and those are the Baba Mountains. And one of the film clips, you'll hear a story of a young man who fled to the Baba Mountains.
Okay. The Afghan kids have staked out what they call a journey to smile. And would somebody tell us about that concept or that image or how they... what that's about?
About a year ago, the Our Journey to Smile concept grew out of a group of young people working with a physician who had come to Bamiyan province. Hakim, as he's known, was a physician from Singapore that went to Pakistan in 2002 to help with the humanitarian effort in the Afghan refugee camps. He then, 2 years later, moved to Bamiyan province, where he got to know these young people. And then last year, the group of young people decided on this Our Journey to Smile to represent the positive aspect that the desire we all have for happiness. And they recorded their first video a year ago and posted it to their website a year ago. And that's how it started.
Now, these kids are inviting other people locally there and other people around the world to join them in this journey to smile. And you folks and others have accepted their invitation. How did you get connected with them initially? What was the story?
The peace groups in the Olympia area, in addition to FOR, Veterans for Peace, there are a number of others that are active. We're kind of keeping an eye on a couple of veterans from the Iraq conflict who had come back to the United States.
They were U.S. veterans.
Marine and an Army veteran that were traveling on foot to begin with and then on their bicycles. Their journey is entitled Contagious Love Experiment. Josh Stieber and Connor Curran were coming to the Olympia area, and so several of us were looking for ways to find places for them to talk. And at their website, Contagious Love Experiment, they had been posting connections to Our Journey to Smile. And that's where we met them.
Let's watch two more of their videos. One that we'll watch right now is Our Journey to Smile. And then right after that, we will watch Love is How We'll Run. So these take a few minutes each, and everybody just seems delighted by the work they do. So let's watch Our Journey to Smile, followed by Love is How We'll Run.
حتی جنگ طالبا بسیار خورد کردم قد فامیل خواهد از عسکای راه که بابا فرار کرد بسیار برد زیاد بود وقتی که پس آمدیم خانه ما پدر خود ندید ما باید این زندگی را ادامه ندید این زندگی سخت مشکلات بسیار زیاد ما باید از زندگی خوب و بهتر داشته باشه از راه سول و آشتی محبت با همت میتواند هر انسان هر جنجایی را تغییر بدهد Dear friends in Afghanistan and the world, we may not make it. But as Gandhi encouraged, with the change we want to see in the world.
جنگ زیاد، اسکر زیاد، با ما بسیار مشکل است.
ما هنوز به سوی راستی و دوستی حرکت میکنیم. یا که ما جوانا خود ما تغییر بیاریم.
بله.
محبت آن طریق است که ما سول میخواهیم.
بیاییم که حرکت کنیم.
So, would tell us about the round-the-clock vigil that happened. It went from October 22 to October 27. Who could tell us about that?
I guess I could start. Because the Fellowship of Reconciliation in Olympia has a history, a long history, of doing vigils. Few of us that saw our Journey to Smile call, asking others to vigil with them, we knew that if we just started, others would be around in the Olympia area to join in, and so we.
Because they were doing vigils, at that same time.
Well, they had let the world know that they were going to start their vigil at 2 o'clock Bamiyan time on October 22nd, which meant it would be at that time 2:30 in the morning Olympia time, and so we started. As their opening flute rang out in Bamiyan, we were at Percival Landing, and then continued for a week, almost a week, in vigil with them. And it was a remarkable experience, as you can imagine, in 40-mile-an-hour winds and rain here and very cold weather there. So we were able to make it through.
And that vigil, Doug, was a 24/7, just like they were doing. So there were people that vigiled here, joined from the vigil, and we're there around the clock for the same period of time that our young people in Afghanistan were vigiling.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's true.
And then it ended on Tuesday the 27th?
The 28th in Bamiyan province, which ended up being
27th
here. And we had committed to this vigil until their ending time, which was established when the Nobel Peace Prize recipient, Obama, had acknowledged or recognized their appeal for the reconciliation of civil hearts. which is a document that they've produced. And we didn't really know when Obama would respond, but the ambassador paid a visit to them and committed to telling Obama about this, their message. And so they decided to stop that vigil, to close that vigil, and wait to hear.
And we will be seeing, during the course of the show, we'll see some photos of us folks at Percival Landing in Olympia the night that vigil ended on Tuesday evening, October 27, in solidarity with them. So they also did a vigil that led up to December 10, when Obama was scheduled to receive the Nobel Peace Prize. Can you tell us about what the Afghan kids were doing leading up to that?
Well, they, during their vigil, the first one, we saw photographs of them drinking tea. And we began to have tea. In fact, the Corey family came down one night. They saw us out there cold and came by and brought tea at 1 o'clock in the morning. Mm-hmm. So tea, serving tea, became part of the vigil there. It was a regular part of their vigil in Bamiyan province. And so we got to talking about this, and it turns out where they're from, there's this 2 cups of tea adage or proverb that with the first cup of tea, we're friends, but over a second cup of tea, we're brothers or family. And so they chose a name.
And a matter of fact, that expression is an Afghan proverb, Glenn, but mm-hmm. often what we hear in the United States is 3 cups of tea, mm-hmm. which was after the book written by Greg Mortensen. Mm-hmm. So apparently that transfer of the, how you would say that expression, 2 cups or 3 cups, mm-hmm. but that second cup, you actually are a brother or a sister. Mm-hmm. And so we started vigiling every day from noon till 1, serving tea.
And that led up to December 10, the day of the Nobel Peace Prize ceremony. Has Ambassador Eikenberry, the U.S. ambassador to Afghanistan, has he delivered the message to President Obama?
Of that we're not sure. The people in Bamiyan province, through their connections to the embassy, have asked to find out. And as far as we know, they haven't gotten a firm answer. They know that the ambassador has their photograph that you saw of all of them huddled around in their tent, ready to be passed on to Obama, but we're uncertain.
Okay. Jesse, I met you at one of these noontime vigils, because mm-hmm. You were vigiling noon to one at Sylvester Park, where the Olympia Fellowship of Reconciliation has been vigiling every Wednesday since March 5th of 1980. And we met, you were helping serve tea along with these folks and others, and then you joined our vigil for a while that day, and it was fun to meet you then.
Yeah.
And you've been involved with this. What hooked you into this?
Well, actually, I've known Doug for a little while, but I got to go to Olympia High School, where we did a teleconference with these youth and with youth that attend Olympia High School. And after seeing the communication and the questions that were asked between them, I was totally hooked. I was like, this is awesome and really exciting. And seeing youth talk about such important issues on a cross-cultural scale was really what hooked me. And so we started vigiling, or I started vigiling downtown with these folks. Uh-huh. And then I think a vigil started at Evergreen State College, where I attend. Uh-huh. Sometimes it was wishy-washy. Uh-huh. And then also at Marshall Middle School, they started doing a vigil for a second cup of tea. And Olympia High School also.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And you've been working with other young people of various ages. Tell us some of what you've been doing.
Yeah, so well, we've done a couple of presentations. Olympia High School was the first one. And then we got to go to Marshall Middle School here in Olympia and share their messages and some of the videos that we're watching on the program today with the youth there. And they were so excited. They're 11-year-olds, and you know, there's 11-year-olds in this group in Afghanistan too. So it's really moving for them to see the impacts of war on their peers that they're not necessarily hearing from MTV mm-hmm. or other TV programs or any kind of media. And so this question of responsibility as youth to other youth starts getting talked about, and it's really exciting and important
to
see.
Then there are questions that the people here have been asking those Afghan kids and vice versa.
Yeah.
What kind of questions and answers are people exchanging?
It's really fun to watch. You get to see what kids in the United States are asking, which is like, what's your life like? How do you get out of the country if you need to? Or have you ever felt like you needed to leave the country? And then a lot of the Afghan kids are asking, have you ever heard directly from an Afghan that they want peace? And the Olympia High School students, when they were asked that, said, no, we've never ever heard from an Afghan who wasn't a terrorist or anything like that. So again, the question of responsibility comes in.
And it's not just Olympia, but all of you folks are connecting with people elsewhere. Where else?
Yeah. Well, I know that there's some public and private academic institutions on the East Coast, like New Hampshire and Massachusetts and New York. There's a few schools that are taking on spreading this message and promoting the awareness, and then also schools here in Olympia. And there's been talk of people starting organizations or already started organizations in Wyoming and Oregon also.
And you told me when we were preparing for the program that there are people in Rwanda and Japan, South Africa, parts of South America that are connected.
Well, when other peace organizations see these videos and the message and how pure it is, they then begin to talk about how they can connect. And one of those organizations is a very important one, the September 11th Families for Peaceful Tomorrows, is concerned that the September 11th event has been used to sell the idea that war is needed.
Right. And these are the family members of people who are killed in the September 11th attacks.
Mm-hmm. Right. Since that time, they have been organizing communication with youth around the idea of peace internationally. And those countries that you've mentioned are places where they already have existing correspondence with youth organizations, and they would like to make sure that all of these youth organizations have a chance to talk to each other.
We want to get a chance to look at the a video we have of the teleconference that occurred at Olympia High School that you mentioned.
Yeah.
It's about 7 minutes, and it shows real people connecting, Olympia High School students plus some adults. You can see Craig and Cindy Corey in there and some other supportive adults. And then it closes with the principal of Olympia High School, Matt Grant.
You know, and what makes this so special is that the adults, the older adults, stood back and let Jazzy lead. So it became truly students to students, and it was a marvelous experience. Mm-hmm. In 39 years of education, I had never witnessed that.
Yeah.
It was just
a powerful
experience. Yeah.
Okay, well, let's watch this. This will be about a 7-minute video of the teleconference at Olympia High School.
Faiz Ahmad and Abdul Aziz spoke first. Faiz Ahmad said that the family wasn't too happy with him participating in the program because they didn't understand the purpose of pursuing peace. Abdul Aziz.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Jalan Mehdi. I'm a senior at Olympia High School. My question is, in your times of trouble, what do you do for fun or recreation to keep things light?
Hit the computer.
Hello, my name's Adam. I'm a student at Evergreen College, and the question I have is, how is the war affecting your day-to-day life? Like, what does the occupancy look like? Do you see troops often, and if you do, what are they doing?
Abdullah, he's 13 years old, he's in the 5th grade, and he says that if international funds are used to build schools and things, that is something which the people appreciate. But Muhammad John, he's 19 years old in the 11th grade, he's aware, like a growing number of Afghans are aware, that 90% of the funds from abroad are spent on the military, and only 10% is allocated for relief and development. And you must say, with all honesty, that 10% which is allocated to relief and development, you will be surprised if even 1% of it reaches us.
Now, what would you guys all like to study when you get older, or what would you like to be when you get older?
Great. I just wanted to thank you again so much. I think I can speak for everybody here that it's really an honor to be able to do this and hear from you all. And we wanted to actually turn it back to you and give you all an opportunity to ask us, the youth here living in Olympia, Washington, USA, to ask us any questions that you have.
I think first question was, do the ordinary Americans have a say in the policies of peace and war in America and in the world? Do the ordinary people have a say?
Okay, who would like to answer? Who would like to answer?
I'll answer.
Be brave.
Well, I don't think that we do have a say, and like we can influence them though, and we can email our senators and our legislatures, and they're supposed to listen to them, and they're supposed to hear our voice, and also international governmental organizations are we can join those, and those influence politics, and hopefully will more in the future. So it's kind of a yes and no answer.
Do you have any information about how much the government of the United States spends on the wall per day?
He's asking me how much.
Okay. Does anybody want to answer that? Anybody have an idea how much the government spends on Afghanistan war
effort?
How much do they spend?
I believe the United States government spends about $4 billion a month on military in Afghanistan.
Hello, my name is Jimmy Robert. I'm a senior at Olympia High School. We are not told as for what the money is spent for. Sometimes we're told that it's meant for peace efforts, but ultimately we are not informed. I think the government is afraid to give some control to, because if we're putting that into peace efforts, the military has no control of what's going on.
More time, we need to hear from you. They were then from us to you. We're going to practice two words. Thank you, Tashakur.
Tashakur.
And peace. Salam.
Salam.
Did you hear?
Yes, thank you, Ben.
Hello, my name is Cindy Corey, and I live here in the community in Olympia, Washington, and I'm really happy to be here with the students today. And I just wanted to say that that I think many people, I don't know the views of everybody in the room, but I think all of us want to contribute to the world that I think you envision, that vision of a peaceful world where we're really working to provide the good things that everybody in the world needs. But we know it's a difficult process because right now our country, even though I think people want peace, we know that we're very invested in war. And I think that what we're doing right now, the good thing about today is that all of these students here in Olympia are hearing your words from Afghanistan, and we're all sitting together as individuals, as people, taking the steps that I think we have to take to make the changes. I wish they could happen faster, but I think that what we're doing right now is an important piece in that, and I just want to thank you for having the courage to talk to us and to give us that opportunity. So thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. To speak on behalf of everybody here, that we are very grateful for your willingness to stay late at night and speak to us
And we learned so much from talking to the people of Afghanistan, and your questions were good ones. But now we can say we have heard the voice of Afghanistan people and incorporate it in our
That's fascinating stuff. What else can you tell us about these kids' firsthand experiences? They've experienced a lot of realities and firsthand encounters with things. What else can you tell us about that?
Well, this is probably the first time that students in an occupied country, Afghanistan, got to speak with students whose country are the occupiers, and the opportunity to learn one from another and learn each other's experiences and what they had in common and what they didn't have in common.
I've been impressed with everything that I've seen from these kids, how deeply grounded they are in compassion and goodwill. I don't see anger and bitterness, but I see a determination for peace and just turning a whole different dimension toward doing things, just a profound universal concern for all of humanity and grounded in human dignity. It's just an amazing and inspiring thing. And they're yearning for peace. What else?
Well, they use the word reconciliation, love, humanity.
Yeah.
This is the Fellowship of Reconciliation show. This is about as pure that you're going to get coming from 9-year-olds to 22-year-olds.
Yeah. And how different from the mainstream approach.
Yes.
That, like you say, otherwise all we hear from is terrorists or something. And it's like, you know, look at the real people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a powerful message. People have been responding well to this. This seems to be like a movement on the upswing.
Well, there is. And they also have a Facebook account, which is a social networking tool that many people have. And people are discovering them because that's how they post their latest updates to their YouTube videos.
Yeah, so Facebook and YouTube and all these new things that even those of us who are over 30 can access if we really wanted to. We've got another slideshow coming up that you put together with photos from quite a lot of different events, some local things, we'll be watching this in just a moment. What can you tell us what we're going to be seeing, and then we can do a little bit of voiceover narration as these slides move
Yes,
along.
Most of the pictures are taken from Sylvester Park, where we had our second cup of tea vigil.
Okay.
And then there are a few from Bamiyong, and then some from Evergreen State College.
And there's also a photo in there, I think, from the Tuesday, October 27 vigil down at First of Landing. I think that was in that sequence as well. So we'll be seeing these, and this will run about 2 minutes of just still photos. So thanks, Dennis, for all the good work you've done in putting a lot of these, preparing a lot of these things for our viewing. So let's take a look at that slideshow and of the vigils and the teleconference. Well, we will be watching that in just a second. We got a lot of complexity here of getting all these things together. So this will be happening very soon. We'll talk as soon as they have it ready, then we can go ahead and move to that. But I do want to thank you, Dennis, for putting together a lot of these things. The kids have produced the videos there, and then you've done a lot of preparation to make things ready for our broadcast on this TV program. And then you put together these still photos.
Right. We took pictures so that we'd have a record of those that were vigiling so that we could encourage our Afghan Youth Peace Volunteers, that there were people standing in solidarity with him.
Okay, so we've been documented as well as those folks documented.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever that slideshow is ready to proceed, we'll go with it. And they can just go ahead and cut us off when that time is right. We got various people who've taken photos in anticipation of this and other uses. You've also got a collage. I think there's a photo of part of the collage in here. Tell us about that.
The Afghan Youth Peace Volunteers had asked people to send photos. And so if somebody sends in, I'm a fan of Afghan Youth Peace Volunteers at Facebook, that photograph then gets clipped and put in a collage of all the faces, hundreds and hundreds, probably near 1,000 now,
okay,
people who said yes.
And the photo that we'll see in this slideshow is near the beginning. I mean, it was just being started, so there are a lot of blank spaces there.
That's right.
So, okay, let's take a look at this slideshow then. Now, this kid is the leader of the group, that 13-year-old. Is that right?
Oh, we're seeing the video now.
Oh, this is a video. This is not a slideshow. This is
The boys in Afghanistan want to say hello to you before we get in the car. Thank you very much for taking the time.
Hello.
Oh.
Hello.
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 And I want to ask you why you're doing what you're doing.
ما صدای تون را در افغانستان و جهان بلند میکنیم و خواستار جواب عمومات و پیغام سلطنت هستیم.
نجات با نجات دور نمیشه و جنگ با جنگ حل نمیشه.
خدا حافظ.
God protect you, Amy.
زمستان و سردی رسیده در افغانستان. در بعض جای آوی شما رو یخ میزنه. در بعض جای سرک بند میشه. ما باید سخت گران بهار جمع کنیم که گرم نگاه کنیم.
ما نسبت به این مشکلات جسمی را تحمل میکنیم. این بهتر است نسبت به دروغ، جنگ، خشونت، غرور. روح ما را تکان میده، سردش، تنهایی است، جدایی است.
ما بعضی وقت تعجب میکنیم که ما از زندگی، تاریخ و انسانیت چه توقع داشته باشیم و ما باید توقع بیجا نداشته باشیم بخاطر که توقع بیجا امید ما را خاموش میسازد.
ما چرا سر استراتژی درست فکر کنیم؟ چرا سر استراتژی با مهربان فکر نکنیم؟
ما هم دیگر تسلیم میتیم میگیم خیر از خدا مهربان است. شما شاید فکر کنید باشد که ما کارهای بهتر انجام میدیم.
اگر خود ما زمستان زنده نمانیم محبت تعامل داره و محبت دوام داره.
آیا راهی حل برای مشکلات افغانستان تنها جنگ باشد؟ آیا زندگی نمی کند راهی حل شلوغانه و نیک تکمیل کند؟
بله محبت یک زمستان دیگر خواهد زنده ماند. بله محبت آن طریق است که ما ظلم میخواهیم.
Habat gani.
Well, this was actually the video that we were going to be showing after the slideshow, and we all recognized that. This was something called American Thanksgiving, Our Afghan Winter, and you could see that. If we can get the slideshow, we'll plug that in here in a moment. But this was actually the next to the last video that we'll be seeing in the program. There will be a wrap-up one at the very end. But these kids are speaking with compassion, with a concern for all humanity, and just a deep yearning for peace, and really kind of a can-do attitude. I mean, you can tell that these kids are not cynical and saying, oh yeah, that would be nice, but we can't do it. These kids are determined to make peace happen. You know, it's like one smile at a time.
And they have all experienced loss in their family, a father, an uncle, others, a grandfather. Mm-hmm. So they know what loss of war means.
Yeah, yeah. And they also don't buy into the notion that of what the United States did after, like, September 11, when a month afterwards Bush attacked Afghanistan, even though none of the hijackers were from Afghanistan. They had just lived there briefly.
And you won't hear the bad Taliban, bad U.S. Occupying forces.
They're free.
That's not in their language.
They're free from judgmentalism. It's all positive. Well, let's look at the slideshow that we were going to see a moment ago, and then we'll be able to talk over the images. So let's go on with that slideshow then.
This is at Percival Landing, where we set up the sign.
Sylvester Park.
Sylvester Park, yes.
Yeah. People drinking tea.
Mm-hmm.
Bob Ziegler drinking tea. Mm-hmm.
And here, many conversations took place between Dennis and
do you want a cup of hot tea? How about a hot hand warmer? Uh-huh. Our youngest vigiler.
Yeah, little kids in the stroller there. It's our Wednesday noon hour peace vigil. We've been there every Wednesday noon hour since March 5th, 1980.
And there is our host.
That's me. In the rain. David Edwards gets great support for his grandpa against war sign. And Terry Zander serving mm-hmm. tea.
And some guests that came by says, oh, sure, we'd like to say hi to our Afghan friends.
Yeah, a lot of people really connected with that concept. Of
Evergreen students.
Yeah.
Yes.
Olympia High.
So I think here's where people are writing down questions to ask.
At the Olympia High teleconference.
Craig and Cindy Corey were speaking to the group, and
Zahid Sharif
gave some background on the whole country.
There's the beginning of the collage.
Yeah, you can see only a few photos there now, but they'll be filling that in.
More Olympia High School.
Yeah.
And Mr. Waddington was just one of those technical wizards who made things happen.
You can see the photograph of the Youth Peace Volunteers. And so as people were talking from Bamiyan province, they were able to see the face.
So thank you so much for sharing that. The peace movement in the United States generally feels pretty frustrated and powerless. People have been trying for years now to stop this war, to prevent the war on Iraq, and both of those have just gone way out of control and have not achieved mission accomplished at all. So people are frustrated. And what insights do you or these Afghan kids have to help people move ahead toward peace and not just get stuck with frustration?
There's certainly an excellent example of persistence and the message that love is the way to ask for peace. When you see how their lives are, and we consider that they're the same age as we are, the peer-to-peer discussions, it does bring a sense of hope. And with the increasing number, I guess, Jazzy, looking to the future, there'll be more conversations via Skype and the internet, and an opportunity for more and more people.
Mm-hmm. And I like the term smile. Mm-hmm. You know, did our viewing audience notice that it was hard to have a grumpy face when the kids were smiling?
Yeah, I've been wondering how many smiles erupted in the viewing audience living rooms.
Yes.
As they're watching.
And maybe a tear
kids.
In the eye as well.
Yeah, that seems to have happened. What are they doing now, and what are their plans for the future?
They've made a decision following the closure of their second vigil to go from valley to valley, from school to school, and like we're doing.
Yeah. So they're doing outreach. And so are you.
And we hope to continue doing outreach and on a national and international level with them, spreading their message.
Okay, and so we want to let people know how to contact them. There's the website, ourjourneytosmile.com, and then there will be a website up and running, youthpeacevolunteers.org, and people can check those out and get connected. We want to get a chance to look at the a closing video. I want to thank Dennis and Jazzy and Doug. I want to thank all the people who've been watching. We'll wrap up our conversation here, and then we'll close with a video These Afghan kids began a journey to smile, and they invite people to join with them. And people from Olympia and beyond really have joined with them in their journey to smile. And I'm grateful that people with you folks and others with the Olympia Fellowship of Reconciliation, the Western Washington Fellowship of Reconciliation, and our national level have all been supportive. The old adage says a journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step, and it may be that a journey to peace starts with a single smile.
We mm-hmm. should also mention that they have incorporated participation from students in Kabul mm-hmm. okay. that have joined them. So very it is good. Spreading there in Afghanistan
okay,
as well.
Great. So yeah. we thank the people who've been watching. Watch the last video in just a moment. The Olympia Fellowship of Reconciliation reminds people that we're all one human family. We all share one planet. We can make a better world, but we all have to do our part, and the world needs what each of us has to offer. So now let's watch the closing video, which they call Peace Must Arise from the Ordinary.
ارزوی شما پر رسول یک ارزوی خاص است یا یک ارزوی عام است؟
ارزوی از مو عام است که تمام مردم سول میخواهد.
مسئولیت بر اردن شو سر کی باشد؟
مسئولیت برای سول برای از ما باشه. ما خود ما باید سول بریم.
اگر جنگ شروع شد گناه از کی است جنگ؟
گناه از خود ما است. باید خود ما سول کنیم. اگر دولت هم جنگ کنیم باید ما جلوگیری شد مو بگیریم.
ما مردم از دولت جلوگیری بگیریم؟
بله.
چرا کم؟
که ما سول کنیم دیگه جنگ فایده نداره.
ما باید منتظر باشیم با رهبران و کلانا که سو بیاره؟
نه ما باید منتظر نباشیم از جای ما مردم اون باید از جای خود حرکت کنیم که صلح بیاریم.
یک رهبر افغانستان گفته بود که ما افغانستان به دریای خون تبدیل نکنیم.
ما مردم افغانستان دریای صلح میکنیم.
ما مردم اون باید حرکت کنیم در مسیر صلح.
ما باید از خانه، از کوه و از شهر حرکت کنیم.
آیا ما مردمی هم نمیتوانیم؟
ما میتوانیم و حرکت کنیم برای صلح.
صلح، صلح، از تای دل ما صلح.
اثری که بلنه میزن من که صلح و عشقی میخواهم جهان که میفهمم.
تشکر میکنم. دعای شما ما رو بخت نمکنه که از خطی در جنگ یک اکنه از من میکنم.